Morag had led her friends from the farm down into the village with the promise of adventure. Little did her friends know, though, that this idea of adventure would occur in the shape of a canal boat. Where will they go? And what would they find along the way? Find out in this next part of the adventures of Morag the Sleepy Cat. And as always, lie back, take a deep breath, and welcome to Snooze with Sam. Morag led the way, delicately cantering across the path to where the canal boat was moored. She ducked under the rope securing the stern to the jetty, and hid just underneath the gangway, out of sight. Turning to the rest, who were still huddled together in the trees looking on, Morag signalled to them that it was safe to come over. Despite this, no one moved initially. Isla, Gammy, Patch, and Fox all stayed firmly put. Clearly, none were sure about this plan, but Morag had said to trust her. And so, after a moment, Patch was feeling brave, and followed the path across to the gangway, also hiding underneath it.
Come on. It's okay, I promise. I'll go up onto the boat, and the rest of you can come aboard.
Morag said, as she sent out words of encouragement. With a sigh, Fox checked the coast was clear, watching for families or any other people using the canal pathway through the village. And, once satisfied, scurried over and followed Morag across the plank to the boat, which bobbed gently in the water. Next, Gammy made the dash, or she dashed as quickly as her legs would carry her. She made it without too much trouble. And then there was Isla, who remained shy and unwilling to go out into the open. Gammy called out to her.
You can do it, Isla. You'll be okay. It's perfectly safe on here.
Isla was so young. She was still learning about everything she might fear. And the idea of stepping onto a boat, or more so, the water, was getting to her a little. She mumbled under her breath and whimpered a little in angst. But eventually she plucked up the courage and thundered across the path with not even an ounce of subtlety. Despite her diminutive size for a cow, the galloping moo shook the ground, and a few faces in the village turned to look. The rest of the gang's faces sank a little. "Steady, Isla," they thought. "Don't attract too much attention." But she was coming straight for them, and at some speed, and they realized they needed a plan ASAP. Morag spotted someone 100 yards away and pointing and calling out, beginning to jog towards them. They needed to leave immediately.
"Quickly, Isla, but just be careful,"
Fox called out, wondering if she'd simply plough into the gangway in a great crash. Though somehow, the wee calf bowled herself up the ramp and almost took Gammy and Fox with her. But she was on. Morag reeled out orders.
"Right, everyone, as quick as you can. Gammy, you take the bow and release the rope there. Patch, you take the stern and remove this tie. Isla, up on top and to the front. You need to look out for what's coming. Fox and I will pilot the thing. Now, how on earth do you start this?"
It only took a few moments, but it felt like an age. Everyone hurried around the vessel, assuming their designated roles, preparing to free the barge from the hold of land. Fox and Morag hopped up onto the stool, trying their best to make sense of all the funny buttons and switches. They shrugged at each other, all the while the approaching people from the village were getting closer. In panic, they pawed at everything they could, and turned things and prodded others, until, miraculously, they felt a great boom from down below, followed by a rhythmical chug-chug-chug as the engine burst into life.
"We're leaving, everyone. Get ready,"
Morag announced, as Fox thrust a pawful of throttle down onto the lever to the left. In that moment, Patch batted at the stern rope until it loosened. Gammy teethed the bow one free, and Isla stood obvious and proudly atop the boat in the breeze, ginger hair flying free in the wind. They were underway, and right on time, as just as they drifted out of reach, three people screeched to a halt just shy of the water's edge. Holding their heads in hand, they couldn't believe what they were seeing, which was fair enough. Before them, motoring out into the open canal, which gleamed beneath the morning sun, was the Lord and Lady McBride's stupendously elegant narrowboat, piloted by none other than two cats, a fox, a deer, and Isla the Highland cow. They had been out on the water for over 20 minutes now, and every one of the fluffy animals was absolutely loving it. It didn't take long to lose sight of the people on the bank, and they'd reached the cover and shelter of draping willow trees in only a few minutes. Just like that, the frantic chaos turned to a complete serenity which none of them were prepared for. Aside from the soft and distant chug-chug of the diesel motor below deck, all they could hear were the sounds of the spring songbirds, the rustle of the breeze through the trees, and the gentle tinkling of the water being parted by the bow of that beautiful boat. They glided through the water in near silence, Morag and Fox with a paw each on the wheel, with Isla calling out occasional directions and adjustments to their path. But that was it. Every one of them filled their lungs with the fresh morning air, gazing up through the draping leaves of the willows, feeling the warm sunshine glitter past their eyes. None of them could remember feeling so relaxed before that point. Patch lay on his side at the rear, watching the slowly travelling ripples spread toward the bank amongst the reeds in a total daydream. Morag wondered how long it would take before he fell asleep. Gammy was up at the front, folded and on her knees, peering down into the water, watching little fish and pond skaters move gently out of the way of the oncoming barge. And Isla. Wee Isla was lying on her back, all four hooves in the air, staring up at the sky in a total state of bliss. Morag and Fox smiled to each other, seeing her there. She was looking at the clouds through the treetops, watching them shift and morph from one shape to another.
"What do you see?"
Fox whispered up to Isla, who remained upturned and transfixed.
"I see... well, I saw a big old hay bale which was rolling down a hill. But that just turned into... a boat. A canal boat. I bet we're up there with it. So happy and having the time of our lives."
Morag peered up also, and to her pleasant surprise, she too saw a cloud that actually resembled a narrowboat, with a few wee wispy shapes on top, which could have been the five of them. How oddly fitting and wonderful. She propped herself up on the steering wheel, leaving Isla be, and kept a lookout for what lay ahead. All was well. The water wound softly from side to side, giving plenty of time to turn. Soon after, the trees began to thin and eventually gave up entirely, which changed the view from fairy tale woodland to vast and enchanting meadows. Everywhere they looked, blossoming flowers shone with a million colours, and fluffy seedlets rode the warm breeze. In the distance, they saw the famous three bridges crossing the Forth River just west of Edinburgh. They must be making a fair bit of ground, Morag thought. A few people walked the path which rejoined the side of the canal, and they waved as they passed. Cyclists sauntered and daydreamed through the sunshine, enjoying their ride. And wee families who feasted on picnics laughed and cried with joy at the sight of them, sailing their lovely little green canal boat. Morag had hoped this endeavour would be fun and exciting, but even she couldn't have imagined it would feel this liberating. So, where shall we go now? Fox asked, as Patch joined them at the wheel.
Yeah, we could go anywhere in the world. Well, maybe not the world, but let's do something exciting.
He added, still full of wonder at their current situation. Morag nodded and pondered for a moment, wanting to stroke her whiskers, before the answer came to her almost immediately.
How about we go over there?
Everyone heard her, and the four of their heads rose up to follow Morag's gaze to the next bend in the river. On the outermost bank, on the left-hand side, was a little jetty, big enough for just one boat. Slightly further down the water, teeing off the footpath, was a gorgeous arch bridge built from the finest stone. It was only small and humped steeply in the middle, and was only wide enough for a very small car at best. It was old, and obviously made when everyone got about on foot or horseback. But it was what lay across the bridge which caught the attention of Morag and the gang. Beyond the path on the opposite side, and through a pair of wood pillars bordered with roses, was a grand driveway leading up to a very stately home. Or was it a farm? Perhaps it was both, for the gleaming whitewash facade of the mansion laid alongside stunning old steadings and stables. Some of these had been converted into what looked like a small open-fronted market, and another a cafe. And outside, there were hundreds of people enjoying a party fare. The entire garden was filled with colourful gazebos, tents, animal pens filled with sheep and cows, and stalls with all the local merchants selling wonderful things to those attending. There were activities, competitions, games, and all manner of other things to do. It looked very exciting, and the five furry friends were desperate to get a closer look.
Yes, yes, let's go there, please. Can we please?
Isla said, practically vibrating with anticipation. And so Fox brought the boat up to the jetty, with an inevitable bump, which lurched everyone unsteady. But she got the job done. Gammy and Patch tied up each end to the jetty, and Isla did her best to shove the walkway into a place they could disembark from. In only a moment, they were moored and hurrying on to dry land. Gammy was first up onto the bridge, with Fox and Patch in tow. From up there, they could see even more. The stately garden was a thing to behold. Every bush, tree, and flower blossomed in a show of seasonal colour, and the fragrances carried on the air. It was absolutely delicious. A perfectly manicured lawn played host to the party, and the whole scene was like that of a postcard.
"Come on, everyone, let's go,"
Patch said as he bounced up onto the bridge wall, then led the way through the pillars and up the drive. The other four followed closely, all 20 paws and hooves lightly crunching the gravel underneath. Upon approach, they weren't really sure what to expect. Morag hadn't thought this far, or thought it through. She merely hoped no one would mind them being there. Morag took the lead, heading straight for the centre of the party, with Gammy, Isla, Fox and Patch close behind her. In front of the house, center stage in the courtyard, was a huge marble water fountain and bandstand in which a music group was playing the Celtic jig. Or at least they were, until one of them spotted the approaching animals and stopped playing, mouth wide open. The rest of the band lulled and tailed off, stopping, all staring too. The crowd then went quiet and turned on the spot, wondering what had happened. There was silence. The entire place stopped and stared at Morag and her friends, clustered together on the driveway. Only the birds sang out. No one else made a sound. Were they seeing things? Had two cats, a fox, a deer and a cow really just walked into the fair on their own accord? Every person there was simply dumbstruck.
What do we do now?
Whispered Fox into Morag's ear, as Isla began to shuffle uncomfortably behind them. But she didn't know, to be honest. Then, before she could begin to get nervous herself, something wonderful happened. The entire party erupted in a volley of cheers. Hands went up. People smiled and cried with happiness. And the band struck up again in joyous music. Streamers and party poppers were launched into the air in a flurry of colourful snow. They were being welcomed with open arms. The five friends were taken aback and looked at each other in bemusement.
Is this good?
Gammy asked.
Are we in?
Just as she said this, a kindly man from the crowd, dressed in tweed and a flat cap, approached them with a gentle hand and an inviting arm, ushering them all in. He allowed them to come forward at their own pace. And as they did, another great cheer followed, and many of the children began to run about and dance. The country fair had inherited five new guests, and they were to be the stars of the show. From that point onwards, the day became a complete blur of excitement and experiences for all of them. First of all, they were guided into the centre, and everyone of all ages came closer to say hello. They gave strokes, pats, and boops aplenty, and the gang loved the attention. Morag and Patch jumped up onto Gammy's back to get a better view, and so did Fox onto Isla. It seemed safest up there anyway, away from everyone's feet. Next, they played a game of chase with the children, who adored having animals to play with. One half had wee coloured hankies to carry and tucked them into their clothes, whilst the other half tried their best to capture them. It took a moment for Morag and her friends to catch on, but once they did, Their agility and speed made them excellent players. Well, aside from dear Isla, who mainly just spun in circles, happily jumping around and playing with the younger children. After that, they toured the stalls and were given a few tasty treats made by local bakers and cooks. Everything they ate was simply delicious, but still not quite a patch on the creations from Blackhill Farm Cottage. A wee old woman gave them all wee knitted scarves each, with a pretty flower dangling from the bottom. Morag was given a red one with a little dandelion. Patches was white with a buttercup. Fox had a lilac one with a bluebell. Gammy a green one with a thistle. And Isla had a big, bright yellow one with a sunflower. They looked lovely and were very pleased to be gifted something so precious. After being fed, dressed, and looking the part, it was time for more games. Egg and spoon race next. Each of the five friends lined up alongside the children on one side of the lawn, with the finishing line 100 yards away on the opposite. The kids held their spoons steady, eggs balancing and shaking a little, whilst the animals were given wee baskets to hang from their scarves. The race began with a cheer, and they were off. Some children lost their eggs early and hurried to put them back on, whilst Isla's egg flew straight out of the basket in the first step. Despite her leg throwing her off balance, Gammy made steady and careful progress. But with two children and the cats not far behind, it was Fox's elegance that prevailed. With her careful steps and balance, making light work of the dash. She took the ribbon at the far side, with a volley of cheers from everyone. Finally, as the afternoon sun was getting low in the sky, and the clouds turned a pinky orange, it was time for them to head home. All the people cheered and waved the famous five friends off as they giddily trotted back down the gravel driveway, leaving the mansion, the party, and the festivities behind.
don't want to go. This was so much fun.
Isla sighed as Fox smiled at her.
Don't worry. I think we'll come back. I'm pretty sure we're quite welcome,
she said. Morag looked back once more, just as the sun was beginning to set on the gardens. She saw the hundreds of people waving and smiling in front of the house as they crossed the bridge and hopped back onto their canal boat. Just like before, she again thought to herself, she'd never, ever imagined their day to be as exciting as this. And she couldn't remember feeling happier. What a day it had been, adventuring with her friends, exploring and experiencing new and wonderful things. She was blessed, and she knew it. And she couldn't wait to get home to tell her own family all about it and have a great big snooze. She was knackered, and she was a very sleepy cat, after all. Gammy the deer and Patch the cat untied the barge from the banks, and Fox set about turning the thing around. Morag went up onto the roof and sat beside Isla, who gazed longingly back to the party.
Do you think we'll have another adventure soon, Morag?
She said whimsically.
Oh yes, Isla, I believe we shall. Don't you worry about that.
And so Morag and her friends set sail for Blackhill Farm, souls full to the brim and filled with joy, into the setting sun, dreaming of where their next adventure might take them.